Welcome, aspiring ethical hackers. Today marks the beginning of an intensive 5-week journey to master ethical hacking. This journey begins by laying a solid foundation of understanding. Just as a builder can't construct a skyscraper without a strong base, we can't master ethical hacking without first understanding computer systems, networks, and cybersecurity fundamentals. So let's dive in. If you enjoy this type of content, let me and YouTube know by hitting that like button. Our journey begins with computer systems. Think of them as intricate puzzles with multiple interconnected components. To be a successful ethical hacker, it's important to not just see the complete picture, but also understand each individual puzzle piece. We'll cover hardware basics, including CPUs, memory, storage devices, and peripherals. Understanding how these components work together can help you identify hardware vulnerabilities, such as unsecured USB ports or unprotected storage devices. So let's start piecing together our puzzle. And where better to start than the heart of the computer, the central processing unit or CPU? This is the primary component of a computer that performs most of the processing inside the computer. It's the brains of the operation, and understanding how it interacts with other components is vital. You'll learn how vulnerabilities in CPU hardware or firmware can be exploited, leading to attacks such as the infamous Spectre and Meltdown. Next, we move on to memory. This includes the RAM, or random access memory, and ROM, read-only memory. RAM is the computer's workspace, the place where the computer temporarily stores data it is working with. ROM, on the other hand, is the permanent memory used for storing critical instructions that boot up the computer. We'll look into how vulnerabilities such as RoHammer affecting RAM can be a potential risk. Storage devices like hard drives, SSDs, and removable storage form another key piece of our puzzle. They hold all the data a computer works with, and understanding how data is read, written, and erased on these devices can open doors to understanding potential data leakages, recoveries, and injections. Then come the peripherals, devices like monitors, keyboards, mice, and printers that a user interacts with. Have you ever thought about how a simple USB device can pose a security threat? Or how keyloggers can use your keyboard against you? We'll delve into these aspects too. For example, recognizing an unsecured USB port or an unprotected storage device can mean the difference between a secure system and a compromised one. This part of our journey is all about understanding the key pieces of the puzzle. Remember, the deeper your understanding, the better you can anticipate, recognize, and exploit system vulnerabilities as an ethical hacker. So, let's put our explorer hats on and start uncovering the secrets of computer systems. Don't forget to subscribe so you don't miss out on my upcoming content in this series. Our main focus will be on understanding operating systems. It's the OS that governs how software and hardware interact. Grasping how these elements function and interact is key to understanding how attacks like privilege escalation or buffer overflow exploits can take place. Alright, future hackers! Let's dive deeper into the realm of operating systems, and don't forget to let me know in the comments which ethical hacking tools you want me to make tutorials for. Let's continue. Every OS, be it Windows, Linux, or macOS, is responsible for managing software applications and hardware resources. And the first aspect we're going to discuss is process management. In layman's terms, a process is an instance of a computer program that is being executed. Whenever you launch an application, a process is created. Each process requires CPU time, memory, and access to files and I/O devices to function. The operating system is the maestro that orchestrates how these resources are allocated and managed. Consider a Windows OS. It leverages a process model where each process has its own, separate virtual address space. Now let's tackle file systems. The file system is responsible for managing how data is stored and retrieved. Take Linux's ext4 file system, for example. It incorporates features like backward compatibility, journaling to prevent data loss, and the capability to support large file system and file sizes. The ext4 file system also maintains access controls and permissions for the security of data. Knowing this helps us understand the implications of unauthorized access and how they can be prevented. Next, we journey into the realm of user privileges. User privileges dictate what a user can or cannot do on a system. For instance, on macOS, there are various levels of user accounts. The admin user can add and manage other users, install apps, and change settings. Standard users can install apps and change settings that affect their personal space. Knowing how these privileges work can help us identify potential points of attack. For instance, an attacker might aim to gain unauthorized admin access in what we call privilege escalation. Lastly, let's look at system calls. System calls are the interface between the application and the OS, and they're used when an application needs to request a service from the OS. Take the read system call in Unix-based systems, for example. It's used to read data from a file, and the data is then stored in a buffer. If an attacker feeds more data than the buffer can hold, it might overflow into adjacent memory, causing unpredictable system behavior. This is a classic example of a buffer overflow exploit. Next, we turn our attention to networks, the superhighways of the digital world that enable devices to communicate. Just as highways have rules for smooth operation, networks run on protocols. Two such protocols, the OSI model and TCP/IP, form the backbone of our digital communication infrastructure. The OSI model is a seven-layered conceptual framework that helps us understand how different network protocols interact to provide network services. We'll dissect each layer, from the physical layer, which covers the actual transmission of data, to the application layer, which interfaces with end-user software. By understanding the functionality of each layer, you can better anticipate where potential vulnerabilities may lie. Now that we've gained a solid understanding of computer systems and operating systems, let's pivot to networking concepts, starting with the OSI model. The Open Systems Interconnection or OSI model is a seven-layered framework that standardizes the functions of a communication system into abstract layers. Let's start from the bottom, with layer 1, the physical layer. This layer is responsible for the actual transmission of data over network communications media. It deals with the electrical and physical specifications of devices. For example, when you're connecting to a Wi-Fi network, the physical layer protocols handle the conversion of data into wireless signals. Climbing up to layer 2, we reach the data link layer. This layer is responsible for node-to-node data transfer. It manages how data is packaged, addressed, transmitted, received, and dealt with on a physical network. Think Ethernet. It operates on this layer, handling the direct transfer of data between network nodes. Layer 3 is the network layer. This is where data is routed across networks. Protocols like IP or Internet Protocol operate at this level. When you're sending an email, the network layer determines the best route for your data to reach its destination. Next, we have layer 4, the transport layer. This layer is all about reliable transmission of data packets. Two main protocols operate here: TCP, Transmission Control Protocol, which provides reliable, ordered, and error-checked delivery of a stream of packets, and UDP, User Datagram Protocol, which prioritizes speed over reliability. Layer 5, the session layer, sets up, coordinates, and terminates conversations between applications. When you log into a remote server, the session layer establishes the connection and maintains it until you log off. Then layer 6, the presentation layer, transforms data into the form that the application layer can accept. It handles syntax processing, encryption, compression, and other transformations of data. Finally, we reach layer 7, the application layer. This is the layer that interfaces with end-user software, like your web browser or email client. When you type a URL into your web browser, HTTP, a protocol at the application layer, formats your request and handles the communication with the web server. By understanding the functionality of each layer, you gain insight into the entire communication process. Each layer has its own unique vulnerabilities. For example, in the transport layer, a TCP SYN flood attack can exploit the TCP handshake process to overwhelm a system with unnecessary requests. Knowing where potential weaknesses may lie allows us to anticipate and counter potential attacks. As we explore each layer, keep in mind that the key to ethical hacking is understanding how each piece fits into the bigger picture of network communication. The TCP/IP protocol suite, on the other hand, is the workhorse of internet communications. It consists of four layers: network interface, internet, transport, and application. Each layer serves a specific function in the process of communicating data across networks. Understanding these functions will empower you to diagnose network issues, identify security loopholes, and implement appropriate defenses. Diving deeper into the realm of networking, let's turn our attention to the TCP/IP protocol suite. Named after two of its most important protocols, TCP, Transmission Control Protocol, and IP, Internet Protocol, this suite is the workhorse that powers the internet as we know it today. The TCP/IP model consists of four layers: network interface, internet, transport, and application. Each of these layers has a specific function in the process of communicating data across networks. The network interface layer, which corresponds roughly to the physical and data link layers of the OSI model, is responsible for transmitting data over the physical network. This layer includes protocols such as Ethernet and 802.11 wireless. An understanding of this layer can help us identify potential vulnerabilities at the physical connection and data link level, such as ARP spoofing, where a malicious actor can link their MAC address with the IP address of another host, redirecting the traffic to the attacker's host instead. Next up, we have the internet layer, equivalent to the network layer in the OSI model. This layer is all about routing data across networks, and IP is the star here. Every device connected to the internet has a unique IP address, which is used to deliver packets to the correct destination. But this routing capability can be exploited in attacks such as IP spoofing, where an attacker sends out packets pretending to be from another IP address. The third layer is the transport layer, where TCP and UDP come into play. These protocols are responsible for end-to-end data communication, providing services such as reliability, flow control, and multiplexing. This is where we see attacks like TCP SYN flood attacks, where an attacker floods a target with connection requests, overloading the target and denying service to legitimate users. Finally, we have the application layer, which corresponds to the OSI model session, presentation, and application layers. This layer interacts directly with the software applications that implement a communicating component. Here, we find protocols like HTTP for web browsing and SMTP for email. Threats at this level can include cross-site scripting, XSS, or SQL injection attacks that aim to exploit a web application's interaction with user input. The better you understand these protocols and layers, the more equipped you will be to safeguard against network vulnerabilities. Remember, knowledge is power, and in this case, your best defense. We'll also dive into network topologies, or how computers are arranged in a network. Now let's take our understanding of networks a step further and explore network topologies. Network topology refers to the arrangement of computers in a network. It's like the architectural blueprint of a network, and understanding it can greatly aid in visualizing data flow and pinpointing critical points of failure or attack. First, let's talk about the star topology. Imagine a celestial sky, with a star glowing brightly in the center, and all other celestial bodies revolving around it. In a star network topology, all devices, or nodes, are connected to a central node. This central hub could be a computer, a switch, or a router. When a device wants to send data to another, it first sends the data to this central hub, which then relays the data to the intended recipient. This centralized nature provides simplicity and ease of troubleshooting, but also introduces a single point of failure. If the central hub goes down, all connected devices lose network connectivity. Next, we have the bus topology. Picture a long highway with houses strung along it. In a bus network topology, all devices are connected to a common central cable, known as the bus. Data from any device travels the length of the bus, available for all other devices to receive. However, collisions can occur if two devices try to send data at the same time, leading to potential network slowdowns or even data loss. We also have the ring topology, where each device is connected to exactly two others, forming a circular network pathway. Data travels around the ring in one direction, from one device to the next. This topology simplifies data flow, but if any one device or connection fails, it can disrupt the entire network. Finally, there's the mesh topology, where every device is connected to every other device. Picture a phishing net, with each node interwoven with others. This provides a high level of redundancy and reliability, as data can travel via multiple paths to reach its destination. However, it can be complex and expensive to set up due to the large number of connections. For instance, in a star topology, protecting the central hub becomes critical due to its pivotal role in network connectivity. Or in a mesh topology, the interconnectivity requires stringent security measures for each individual connection. By thinking about networks this way, we enhance our ability to secure them. A key component of our first week is encryption, the process of encoding data to prevent unauthorized access. We'll delve into symmetric encryption, where the same key is used for encryption and decryption, and asymmetric encryption, where different keys are used for each process. Understanding these methods will aid in securing data transmission and storage, and also help identify potential weaknesses in encryption implementations. Encryption in its most basic form is the process of encoding information in such a way that only authorized parties can access it. It's like having a secret language between you and a friend that no one else understands. But in this case, it's not just about keeping secrets from nosy siblings, it's about maintaining privacy, ensuring data integrity, and verifying authenticity in the vast digital landscape. First, let's discuss symmetric encryption. This is the simplest type of encryption, where the same key is used for both encrypting and decrypting the data. Imagine you have a box, and you have a single key that can both lock and unlock that box. That's symmetric encryption. One common symmetric encryption algorithm is the Advanced Encryption Standard, AES, which is used worldwide. While symmetric encryption is fast and efficient, it has a significant drawback. If the key is lost or stolen, anyone can decrypt the data. Also, sharing the key between parties securely can be a challenge. That's where asymmetric encryption comes in. In asymmetric encryption, different keys are used for encryption and decryption. One public key that can be freely distributed and used by anyone to encrypt messages, and one private key that is kept secret by the recipient and used to decrypt messages. If we go back to our box analogy, it's like having a box with two different keys. One key can only lock the box and the other key can only unlock it. RSA, Rivest Shamir Adelman, and ECC, elliptic curve cryptography, are common asymmetric encryption methods. These encryption methods are widely used to secure data transmission and storage. For example, when you browse a website starting with HTTPS, your connection to the site is secured using SSL, TLS, cryptographic protocols that use both symmetric and asymmetric encryption for securing data in transit. Understanding these encryption methods is crucial not just for securing data, but also for identifying potential weaknesses in encryption implementations. For instance, using a weak or predictable key in symmetric encryption can leave the data vulnerable to brute force attacks. In the case of asymmetric encryption, if a private key is somehow exposed, the security of all encrypted data is compromised. As an ethical hacker, being familiar with these encryption techniques will help you assess the security of encrypted data and suggest improvements. Remember, encryption isn't just about keeping secrets, but it's also about maintaining trust in the digital world. Finally, we'll explore common cybersecurity threats and attack vectors. From malware, which includes viruses, worms, and ransomware, to phishing attacks that trick users into revealing sensitive information, understanding these threats is crucial. We'll also look at denial-of-service attacks, which aim to make resources unavailable to users, and man-in-the-middle attacks, where the attacker secretly relays and possibly alters the communication between two parties who believe they are directly communicating with each other. Understanding these threats will equip you with the knowledge to anticipate and protect against them. In the final part of this week's journey, we venture into the darker side of the digital world, the realm of cybersecurity threats and attack vectors. Like learning about the diseases before we can cure them, understanding these threats is a crucial step to anticipate and protect against them. Let's begin with malware, a term that's short for malicious software. As the name implies, it's software specifically designed to cause harm. It's an umbrella term covering a host of nasty things like viruses, which self-replicate and spread infection to other programs and files. Worms, self-contained programs that spread across networks. And ransomware, a particularly insidious type of malware that encrypts your data and demands a ransom for its release. Malware can be used to steal sensitive information, disrupt operations, or simply cause havoc. For instance, the infamous WannaCry ransomware attack in 2017 affected hundreds of thousands of computers worldwide, causing billions of dollars in damages. As an ethical hacker, understanding how these threats work helps you develop strategies to combat them. Next on the list are phishing attacks. These cunning exploits trick users into revealing sensitive information like passwords or credit card numbers. It often involves an attacker posing as a trusted entity, like your bank or an online service, and manipulating you into giving up your data. These attacks prey on human psychology, and part of your role as an ethical hacker will be to educate users on recognizing and avoiding such threats. Denial of service, DOS, attacks are also a major concern. These attacks aim to make a resource, like a website or online service, unavailable to its users, typically by flooding the target with superfluous requests in an attempt to overload systems and prevent some or all legitimate requests from being fulfilled. You might remember the Dyn attack of 2016, where major websites like Twitter, Reddit, and Netflix were taken down by a massive DOS attack. Lastly, let's discuss man-in-the-middle, MITM, attacks. In these attacks, the hacker secretly intercepts and possibly alters the communication between two parties who believe they're directly communicating with each other. Imagine having a private conversation with a friend, only to discover someone was secretly listening in and altering your messages. That's a MITM attack. These can happen on unsecured Wi-Fi networks, where an attacker can eavesdrop on data being sent and received. This knowledge is our launching pad, our base camp from which we'll ascend into the world of ethical hacking. So, let's keep the spirit of inquiry alive, remain committed, and remember, we're hacking for a cause, to make the digital world a safer place. Subscribe and stay tuned for the next episode of this series.